Hello everybody, this is part three of our look at the cities of refuge, and I'm going to be looking at we're going to be finishing off our little look at how the cities of refuge were distributed throughout the land. And in Romans chapter 3 verse 29 to 31, Paul says, "Or is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also the God of the Gentiles?" That's me and you, by the way. "Yes, of the Gentiles also, since there is one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith." That's talking about Jewish people and non-Jewish people. "Do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law." So he also told the church in Ephesus in the book of Ephesians chapter 1 verses 13 to 14, "In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, to the praise of his glory." So, from the words of Paul and Jesus, we understand that the path to salvation is no longer complicated as it was in the Old Testament times. In the New Testament times, the church age, as we call it now, those who approach the city of refuge, God's true church, need only to enter the door with faith. In this way, we can receive Jesus Christ, who came in the flesh, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the one true God of yesterday, today, and forever. Having faith means obeying him to receive water baptism and regeneration through the Holy Spirit, as we read in John chapter 3, verse 5. This is the only way for justification, for God to look us just as if we'd never sinned, and sanctification. That is a process of being made right, of right living, holiness. So the six cities were a refuge for everybody. As we read in Numbers chapter 35 verse 15, "These six cities shall be for refuge for the children of Israel," that's the Jews, "for the stranger," that's the non-Jew, "and for the sojourner," that's the traveller, "among them, that anyone who kills a person accidentally may flee there." So according to the law of Moses, anyone who killed accidentally could seek asylum in a city of refuge. Israelites, foreigners and travellers. This point highlights the universal nature of God's salvation, which was evident, to be honest, even in the Old Testament period. And if we look at the book of Noah, for example, and the book of Jonah, we see that God's grace extended to the Gentiles also, people who weren't Jewish. Hence, when God made his seven great promises to Abraham, he said, "I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." That's your family and my family. And we get this from Genesis chapter 12, verse 2 to 3. Also, the prophets reveal God's universal salvation plan repeatedly. For example, Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 2, verse 2, "Now it shall come to pass in the latter days," that's the day in which we're living now, "that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it." And Habakkuk said in chapter 2, verse 4, "Behold the proud, his soul is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith." So this is the basis of the doctrine of justification by faith that Paul expounded in Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 to 29, where we read, "For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seeds and heirs according to the promise." Hallelujah. So, for this reason, he became a proactive messenger to the Gentiles, and thank God that he did. Otherwise, you and I would never have heard the gospel. And he says in Galatians chapter 2, verse 7 to 8, "But on the contrary, when they saw that the gospel for the uncircumcised," that is you and I, "had been committed to me, as the gospel for the circumcised," that is to the Jews, "was to Peter, for he who worked effectively in Peter for the apostleship to the circumcised also worked effectively in me towards the Gentiles." That's talking about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, the power of God, was working through the Apostle Paul to bring the gospel to you and me. Hallelujah. So it's got to be true that even though the Jews were entrusted with God's truth from ancient times, we read in Romans chapter 3, verse 1, and were obliged to uphold the Mosaic law, God did not abandon the other nations, and thank God that he didn't. He extended his saving grace to them, that is us. And in the New Testament age, the age of the church in which we're now living, we as Gentiles, that's non-Jewish people, have received this salvation directly from God through the spiritual city of refuge, which is his true church. The outcome of which is that we have been liberated or set free from the bondage of Satan and this world, and his grace puts an end to our punishment in the wrath of God. We no longer have to face the wrath of God. So let's have a look now at remaining, what those people had to do. They had to remain to stay safe. They had to remain in the city of refuge. They had to stay there. So although the manslayer could find refuge and protection from the avenger of blood, that is the person nominated by the family of the deceased to take revenge, or it could be a mob, there was a crucial condition. But if the manslayer at any time goes outside the limits of the city of refuge where he has fled, and the avenger of blood finds him outside the limits of his city of refuge, and the avenger of blood kills the manslayer, he shall not be guilty of blood, as we read in Numbers chapter 35, verses 26 to 27. So, the city of refuge was the sole place of safety. During the time of Joshua, the regulation stated, as we read in Joshua chapter 20, verse 4, "And when he flees to one of those cities and stands at the entrance of the gate of the city and declares his case in the hearing of the elders of that city, they shall take him into the city as one of them and give him a place that he may dwell among them." So in other words, the manslayer could present his case to the elders and repent. Now this process was important because human life is precious, and any form of killing, even if it was accidental, could not be viewed lightly. And the manslayer had a duty to show that he would not repeat the offence. And furthermore, his life was at risk from potential avengers. Because his life was at risk from potential avengers, he had to flee to the city of refuge and not attempt to leave. It was only when the high priest passed away that he could safely return home, as we read in Numbers chapter 35 to 28. Now we're going to finish this video here. We'll come back for a part four where we'll wrap up this teaching on the city of refuge. So see you in part four. Thank you.